Sit tail. Hard head. Hup.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Riverside National Cemetery, the directing staff, we'd like to thank you for choosing Riverside as your loved one's final resting place. At this time, we will be having honors. There will be the folding of the flag, the playing of taps, the firing of weapons, and then the playing of taps. At the playing of taps, if everyone would place your right hand over your heart, if you are a veteran, you may render a final hand salute at that time. Thank you.
Video.
Raise it, home!
all of you that took your time to come here today from far distances. And to me, one of the greatest gifts you can give to anybody is your time, because it's the greatest thing that we can only, that we have personally, that we can give someone. Today we come to honor, I don't want to say this, it would be Richard Paul Boughey, also known as Dick. And he's kind of has a famous name to me, because when I was growing up in Hemet, and I had just got out of the Air Force, and I remember that Dick's Cleaners, up until that time, the only cleaners I knew were Borders Cleaners. And whereas I got to know Borders Cleaners very well for quite a while, I never went across town to make it to Dick's. Now I wished I would have. But as you have a treasure chest of memories, I hope I can add to some of those treasure chest of memories, especially for your grandkids today. Because to me, that's what this is all about, is giving you some information about your grandpa that you can carry with you for hopefully the rest of your life. 92 years young. But you know, if your grandpa would have had the opportunity to have all of his friends here, over the years, we couldn't put them in this place. Because from what I've understood from Bill and Paul and Bobby, and I got to know him through them, from what I understand, he was like a people magnet, especially kids. He loved talking to kids. And one of the songs, and I won't say which one, said to me, it takes a kid to know a kid. And I think that's true. I think that's what kept him young. Because from what I'm understanding, he really had a young heart. But he never met a stranger either. And some of you have that same trait, some of your grandkids. You'll have those traits. And just know that where that came from is your grandpa. He was one of nine siblings. And one of the things that I've never heard before, but thanks to his sister sitting here, told me this. There were two boys, then a girl, then two boys, then a girl, then two boys. And that's how all that worked out. Your mom couldn't have planned it any better. The last girl, right? I imagine you have quite a few stories you have about your brother too, huh?
Oh, have a large family and just have a lot, things that go on.
Yeah. Unfortunately, you had a lot of hand-me-downs, right?
No, not really.
No?
No.
Oh, then you must have been a spoiled.
I couldn't wear them. They're all older than me, so I can wear them.
But for Bridget and Danielle, Aaron and Bethany, which is which? You're
Bethany and Danielle.
Thank you. Dick graduated from Rochester High School in Michigan. I did find that out, right? Right. And he served 2 years, one in the Army Air Corps, and then when they broke off the Air Corps part and made it Air Force, he served a year in that. One of his jobs when he was overseas in Guam, he was in the transportation department, from what I saw on his DD-214. And in the transportation department, I understand from Claudia that he used to transport the servicemen coming in to Guam to the hospital, which I think was a pretty neat thing. He probably really had some compassion and stories that he probably told the most of you during that time. And then when he was at his next station for 7 months, he was on the phone a lot because he was part of it, chasing UFOs. And I'm not so sure if it was UFOs that were, when we think of UFOs, or just it was unidentified flying objects. But I hope you guys have got some stories on that you can tell, or maybe not. Family vacation trips when the kids were younger, meaning Bill, Paul, and Claudia. Family trips were taken each year, camping trips to Big Bear, Yellowstone, Northern California, to a place called Jedi Smith Camp, Campground, Lake of the Ozarks and the Redwoods in California, and they took a couple of cruises to Hawaii and Alaska later on in life. So they did get to travel a lot, and they did get to camp a lot. And you grandkids got to do the camping, or did that get past, stop before you, just a little? It's kind of something that we used to do back in those days, but now it's like with everybody in their busy schedules, camping is not one of the things that are unfortunately up there. When you grandkids came into the house, is there any smells or anything that you would have, as soon as you walk in, you knew you would feel when you walked into that house? I'll give you a hint, maybe just to, if you could think of it before we leave, I'd like to write it down. But I remember walking into my aunt and uncle's house, walked straight into the house for years and years and years, and there's always M&Ms in a jar straight ahead for the kids. And then when I got older, they were for my kids, but they were also for me too. But those were kind of the things that I expected when I went into my aunt and uncle's house. But how about you? Do you guys remember anything of it specifically that you can remember when you walked into the house?
The slot machine.
This condo in Colorado always smelled like chicken pot pie.
That's cool. Well, I've got a place for the slot machine to fit. in some of the notes I've got, especially his trips that he made after he got the boilers going when he was in Carson City. Yeah, Carson City. He'd get the boilers going, and he'd either go to hang out at one of the breakfast places with his buddies, or else he'd go to the casino and play there for a while. Kind of a ritual. Amazing how we get into those rituals. And the chicken pot pie, I thought was interesting because that one was something about the food that I didn't know. I can find it. I said to Claudia, I says, what was your dad's favorite food? She said, barbecued ribs. And then I got also chicken fried steak. And I believe it was Bill. And, but one before that is, did your dad like to cook? And it was told to me that he was only good at putting Eggos in the toaster. And another one that I got from Paul was, he liked to eat more than he liked to cook. But his favorite place was barbecue ribs, and he did eat them a lot. And his favorite restaurant was one that he ate at in Texas, and then when they happened to get one in Colorado, Cheddar's. I've never heard of Cheddar's, so I'll have to look that up one day. In fact, just so you'll know, Bill tried to talk me into getting my wife and moving to Texas, so. He ought to be on the Chamber of Commerce. Favorite dessert forever? You guys know it? The grandkids? Favorite dessert? Apple pie topped with ice cream. And that's gone on for years and years.
Microwave for 15 seconds.
You got that down, yeah? 15 seconds. Favorite tea to drink in the morning was coffee. And in the afternoon, drink was iced tea. We loved the big band sounds of the 40s and the 50s. And he and Pat loved to square dance later on as they were getting their young married life started in Upland. They went square dancing. But actually, I was told that he liked all kinds of music. I asked Claudia, I says, what will you remember most about your dad? And this kind of brings out his the softer side of Dick. Claudia said, in her memory, she was either in first or second grade, and she stayed home from school because she was sick. But I don't think she was really sick because she was bored. And if you're sick, you're not bored. But she said that he came into the bedroom with a, with a needle and thread, and he taught her how to sew that very day, and sew the stitches so that they were straight stitches. And then another thing he used to do, like a lot of us grandpas and fathers, is when there's a girl involved, a daughter, a granddaughter, we buy stuff that the parents or their mother won't buy them. Well, in this case, Dick bought her go-go boots. He was a people person, like I said, and he could talk to anybody. And there's times when the boys and Claudia's mom would be out eating somewhere, and she'd say, come on, let's go, let's go. And he said, I'll be there in a minute, which was usually 3 or 4 or 5. But it's because he was talking to somebody, he had a conversation with somebody. And I can so bear witness to that, especially staying in the same town as you were born in. And some other good things, he was a highly social person. Bill says he was a highly social person. He would be able to con people sometimes. An example was, if he was working on a project and someone came along to give him some advice and would say, well, this is how you do it. And he said, well, can you show me? Can you show me how to do it?
Yeah.
And they'd get over there and they'd do it for him. Which I think is neat. But he also learned, he watched and learned how to do it. They went to the, in their younger years, they went to the First Christian Church of Ontario before coming to Hemet. And then when they got to Hemet, they joined the First Christian Church. And it's in Harvard and Acacia Streets in Hemet. And the family became very active in the activities, especially during the Christmas plays, as most do, which I think is commendable. And one of the things I asked was maybe how to close this, and I'm sorry this is so short and we can't do more, but from what I've learned of your grandpa, he had a relationship with the Lord more than he had a religion with the Lord. And a lot of us older people do that. It's we don't go to church every Sunday, but we know the Lord. We get up early in the morning, we pray, we talk, and things like that. And we have a conversation with him. It's kind of like when you girls, or you find a girl one day, once you start a relationship with somebody, you're going to want to spend more time and more time and more time and more time with them. And you get to know them. And you get to know them through just praying. You get to know them through reading the Bible. And you get that relationship and you never lose it. And one of his favorite passages was in Psalm 23. And I hope you'll forgive me for this, but I took this instead of King David writing this poem at the peak of his life. Instead of him writing it and me saying it to you, I felt like, I think this is what Dick would say. And I wanted to leave you with this because I really feel that he lived, for the most part, as much as he could, his Christian life. Yeah, he was a little stubborn, but always. But it goes like this. The Lord was my shepherd, and he's given me all that I needed. He let me rest in green meadows, and he has led me beside peaceful streams. He also has renewed my strength over the years and guided me along the right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walked through the darkest valleys of my life, I was not afraid, for he was close beside me. His rod and staff protected and comforted me. He even prepared a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. He also honored me by anointing my head with oil. Truly, my cup has truly running forward with his blessings. His goodness and unfailing love has pursued me all the days of my life. And now I will live in the house of the Lord forever. And I truly believe that. I truly believe that. And I truly believe that we'll see him one day. And he's glorified by him. And I look forward to seeing him and praising the Lord that I got to be part of this service to honor him. And you guys can honor him too through your lifestyle. And if for whatever reason you haven't made a commitment to the Lord, the only thing I could say, be short and to the point, is ask God if he's real. If you're real, God, prove it to me. Every one of us are different, and he'll talk to each one of you in your own way. For me, and I do not suggest it, but for me, when I challenged him, there was a Bible beside my bed, which to me is a miracle because I didn't allow Bibles in the house. But that night, I had seen a movie, and I came home and I said, God, if you're real, I want you to prove it to me. And I went like this, in a Bible. It wasn't the King James Bible, it was a living Bible. And it says, I will take a well-known sinner and I will turn him around, and I will show others through him that I am alive. I put it down, walked in and told my wife, I said, I just want you to know something. We're going to start church not next Sunday, but the week after, because next Sunday is Easter. We're going to go, because I don't want to go with the hypocrites. I went to the next Sunday, and the rest is history. But the thing is that I want to just, if things get rough and just unbelievable or overpowering, just ask God if he's there, if he's real. And I don't know how he'll tell you that he is or show you that he will be. Heavenly Father, I commend Dick to you today. And Father, I thank you that I believe he's standing right up there in heaven today. Now, whether he sees us or not, I don't know because you don't tell us. But Father, if he is, there's some really great people sitting here, Father, to honor him. And I hope he understands and knows that. And I thank you for the effect he, in his lifetime, had upon everyone in this room. And Father, I thank you that you're giving them safe trips back to where they have to go. And I just ask for grace and mercy to everyone that's here that hears this today. And I ask you that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Rudy?
Thank you, Chaplain Rod. And Elvis Ron. These are some of the shells fired. You can pass that among everybody. Okay. That does conclude the service here. I'd like to have Paul Bear please come up. That's someone who wanted to jiggle the fire. So, make sure the brakes are just stopped.
Thank you.
Yeah, I heard the brakes over here. That's okay. We're coming in.